What's up, everybody, and welcome to another episode. Hit the like button, subscribe to my channel, and share the video. Hit the join button and become a member. Why? Well, members get exclusive content. Hit the bell icon on my channel so that you will receive a notification every time that I drop a video. You can go and check the video out, like the video, and leave a comment if you support me and support the channel and support helping the youth and others, grown people. Let's get into the story. This was a tragic event. Now, I could have sort of saved this for the series that I'm about to do that you guys have been asking for regarding Tiny Goofy and Porgy. However, I'm gonna do this now, and the people involved in this story shall remain nameless, but perhaps you can surmise who I'm talking about considering the statement that I just made. If you know, you know, use your head. The two people involved in this story have passed away. One, as the thumbnail alluded to, was unalived on this very day. And the other passed away tragically, which I will get into eventually, perhaps at the end of this story. This transpired in the Los Angeles County Jail in 2000. It had to be 15. I was there in the module in 26-2800. And in fact, Milk was my cellie over here at this time. And I'm not sure that Milk was in the cell with me when this incident right here transpired. He may have came a few days after. But I do know who was in the cell with me for sure, the homie from Inglewood Family and the homie Baby Folo from 7-4 Hoover. Next door to me was the young homie who shall remain nameless, but he is was a very crazy Hoover. You could not be from Hoover and not have heard this name on the street. This is before he even got locked up. And when he got locked up, his legend really continued to grow because, as I've alluded to before, he was terrorizing the opposition there in the Los Angeles County Jail. Put simply, he was not all there. He represented Hoover wholeheartedly and to his core and to his soul. And he really abided by the rules and the politics and the protocols. Now, so much so that on the street, he had shot one of the ex-homies who was supposed to have been snitching. Now, the problem was he didn't have the paperwork, but the homies had the paperwork on this dude from Nine Deuce who was telling. And they was protecting him because his family was someone pretty big. His cousin or uncle, I know who he is. Now, so he was being protected by certain corners, but the homie in question from 107, the young homie, he didn't believe, once again, in flouting or transgressing against these rules and protocols, no matter who you were and where you were from. And so, though he didn't have the paperwork in his presence, in his person, he had read the paperwork and knew that this dude was a rat. And so, though others were not taking care of business because of who his family was, the homie decided that that did not matter, that the rules mattered more. And so, one day, out there on the street, he caught this dude riding down the street, and he shot at him, and he shot him. He hit him once or twice, just in the leg. When he did that, this dude's family, again, someone pretty big from Hoover. Well, he came back and shot the homie that had shot his family member that was the snitch. He came back and shot him. This was going on the street. So the young homie shot the snitch. He shot the rat. And the dude is now PC in prison. The homies got this dude off the yard, the one that the homie shot. So he was a rat. So the homie had all right to bust on him, and he did. But again, he was being protected by certain pockets. And he was the family member of a monumental figure in the Hoovers. And this family member returned fire. He came back outraged that the young homie had shot his family member, even though he knew that his family member, that he liked cheese, that he was a rat. And so, there in the county jail, the young homie that had shot this dude that was the rat, he's next door to me. And again, he's in the county jail terrorizing the opposition. And he puts his hands on homies who are not performing as well. He takes no prisoners. Very strong, very methodical, very warrior-like. Well, one tragic day, the young homie who is under the homie that was the snitch, the ex-homie that was the rat, that the young homie that's next door to me has shot out there on the street, he's under him. He has the name under him. He's baby so-and-so. He comes one tragic day to jail. And he then comes to the Los Angeles County Jail. And as an ill fate would have it, out of all the modules he can go to, he came to our module, And of all the tiers he could have went to, he came to our tier. And out of all the cells he could have went to, they put him in the cell next door. How crazy is that? When I thought about it later, I said, how tragic. And I saw him coming down the tier. I didn't think much of it. I greeted the homie outside the cell door, stuck my hand out there. What's up, so-and-so? Oh, what's up, big bro? Man, ain't nothing. I realized he's going next door. I still didn't think too much of it, though I know who this dude is, and I know what transpired on the street with the homie next door and this dude's big homie. And I know that the homie next door, again, the light is on, but nobody's home when it comes to him. And he goes inside of the cell. And I promise you, it was no more than 10 seconds later, I heard a nasty thud. Boom! A nasty boom. But it was clear that something or someone had hit the concrete in the cell. There in the Los Angeles County Jail, the floors are hard concrete. And that's the sound that it had made. I heard no one talking from the time the young homie had witnessed cell, the door had opened and he walked in. No one said anything. I didn't hear anything over there, not a word. Just 10 seconds later, I heard a loud bang, a loud sudden boom, a thud that was nasty. And then complete silence. I said, what the hell? And so I go to the bars and I call out to the young homie that's next door. So-and-so, man, you straight? What the fuck was that? He said, yeah, I'm straight, big bro. Come to the bars. Now, they're in the Los Angeles County Jail. You can look from on either side of the cell and you can pretty much see the dudes in the next cell if they're on the bars. You can like see a part of their face. You can see their eyes. And he told me to come to the bars. And I went to the bars and I went out and I looked to the side of the cell where he's at. And he came to his side of the cell and we were face to face. I said, "What's up, bro?" He said, "Bro, I just knocked this dude out, man." And he hit his head. And when he hit his head and he went out, I just lost it, bro. And I picked him up and I slammed his head again up against the concrete. And that was the second thud, the second nasty sound that I had heard. It was two. The first one, complete silence. And then seconds later, I heard a second. Boom, the same nasty, deadly sound. And he said, and now he's over here and he's out cold. What should I do? I said, "Oh man." And then all of a sudden, I heard the younger homie over there moaning, soft, nearly discreet moans. Ah, ah, but the moans were sort of faint. And I said, "Bro, throw some water on him. Throw some cold water on him right now. Put him on the, get him off the floor, put him on the bed and throw some water on him." So that's what he did. I heard him go to the sink, I heard the water running, and then I heard him splashing with the water. And that's the only time, really, that the young homie began to make louder sounds, began to come to just a tad bit, because he began to say, like that. But then it got louder than it was before. Before, it was remote and faint, the sounds that he were making. He was coming to just a bit. And then all of a sudden, the sounds and the moans became very low again. And so the young homie came back to the front of the cell and he said, "Bro, he still ain't really moving and he's making these faint sounds. You can hear him over there, right?" I said, "Yeah, I hear him, bro. But just keep throwing water on him and shake him, bro. Shake him some and try to get the homie to come too." So he did it. He did that again. Threw some water on him and he's trying to get the homie to come too. Now, at this juncture, the homie, it's been about 15 minutes and he's still not moving. And he's making sounds, but they are very faint, very remote, and they're continuing to fade. And not long after, a few minutes, I told the homie it was time to call the police. It was time to call the deputies and get the homie some medical attention right now before you have a case for unaliving. And people are going to be upset because this is a young homie that you just did this to and you have a personal beef with him, but he's not a rat or nothing like that, bro. You know what I'm saying? It's like, this ain't finna go well. Get him out of there right now. Get the young homie some help. I told the young homie. He said, "Okay, bro, okay." So we start calling man down. That's what we do in the Los Angeles County Jail. You call man down, man down. And the police these days, they take their time. They think everybody's faking the injury or whatever. So everybody started yelling man down, telling the whole tier, "Man, everybody yell man down. Get the police down here right now. Emergency 911 for real, man down." So everybody yelling man down, the police do come. And the police come and say, "What's going on? What happened?" And the homies say, "He fell off the bunk. He must have fell off the bunk." But now, the young homie, he's very unremorseful. He doesn't give a damn about what he just did. When he's talking to me, he has a crazed look in his eye. And he's talking like, "Man, this motherfucker ain't moving, bro. What the fuck should I do, man? Wake this motherfucker up? Or just let this motherfucker die or what, bro?" He talking like that. Because again, he's not all there. And he has a beef with this dude. And he wants to take care of this beef. And if he unalives him, apparently, he's okay with that. He's all in at this point. And so he told the police and others in the cell, man, he fell off the bunk. And the police said, isn't this the one that just came in the cell a little while ago? And he's like, yeah, he came in, was making up his bunk or whatever, got on his bunk, probably was tired, been in the holding tanks all night or whatever, I don't know. Came in and he fell off his bunk. And that's what he said. And the police said, okay. And they called for medical. And medical, they took a little time, as they normally do in the Los Angeles County Jail. But then they showed up. And when they showed up, I came to the bars. And they ran in the cell and they grabbed the young homie. And they put him on a stretcher and they brought him out in front of the cell and had him right there for a minute as they was closing the cell and all of that. And I was looking at him and he really had no noticeable injuries on his face. No black eyes, no missing teeth, no bloody nose, no broken jaw. But it was the back of his head that had the injury. They had laid him on his side so that the back of his head wouldn't be hit in the stretcher. And when they laid him on his side, on his left side, and I looked and saw the back of his head, it was nasty. It was very swollen and it was bleeding. And the young homie was on his side and he was barely moving. And he was just making very, once again, faint noises and faint sounds. And I thought, well, this doesn't look good. And a couple of hours later, the deputies came and they searched the cell next door to see, I suppose, what had really happened in there and to try to gather some more information. They pulled everybody out of the cell and they talked to them individually. Did he really fall off the bunk? What happened in there? Something is not adding up. Everyone, they stuck to their story. And they said, yes, he fell off the bunk. That's what happened. No one laid a hand on him. And the police said, okay, he bet not die. We'll be back. And well, a couple of days later, as the young homie laid there in the hospital, fighting for his life, holding on for a few days as they had him on life support. And they began to say that if he does survive, he would be a vegetable at the very least. And well, in part two, I'll tell you how the story ended. And it was tragic. And it was crazy how both of the people involved met their end. But there in the cell where this incident transpired next door to me, well, it became extremely chaotic. And more violence ensued in the cell next door to me. After this had already happened to the young homie because someone was trying to cover their tracks and get someone else to take the case. And so he devised a plan and he said, I'm going to disabuse everyone of the notion that snitches are allowed to hang around in every hood these days. And let me disabuse you of the fallacy that snitches can snitch and still come around. Allow me to disabuse you of that notion. That is not the truth. Some hoods don't tolerate it to this day. Some people do not tolerate it to this day. And he was one of them. And so there in the cell, after he pulled off this tragic event, and I'll again tell you how it ended, well, he became even more violent in the cell. against yet another Hoover. Part two of a Hoover unalives another Hoover is coming up. Stay free, people!